we're celebrating an outstanding talent. We're going to meet one of Britain's most successful and glamorous stars. She's sold 68 million records. She's made 32 films. She's won 2 Grammys, the first one in 1964 for this song.
When you're alone and life is making you lonely, you can always go downtown. When you've got worries, all the noise and the hurry seems to help, I know. Downtown.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Miss Petula Clark. Pleased, everyone. I'm particularly pleased to see you, Petula, because not having met you before, I only knew your clothes, which I have to say, when I was very first on television and I needed something really glamorous to wear, I wore the most beautiful pink silk dress, and inside it was your name tape, Petula Clark.
You were wearing my clothes?
I was wearing your cast offs.
Oh, good for you.
The other thing I wanted to say to you is I wanted to congratulate you on behalf of everyone here on your honour this year, your CBE.
Yes. Thank you.
How did you hear about it first? Tell us.
Oh, I heard about it first from, well, I think I heard about it first from Claude. He was in Geneva, I was in London, and he called me on his mobile, and he's not very good with his mobile, and he also insisted on speaking in English. Now, his French I can understand, but his English is pretty rustic, shall we say.
Shall we explain that this is Claude Wolff?
This is, yes, my husband.
Your husband?
Yes, and he's French. And he speaks French very, very fast, and he tries to speak English very fast too. So he was saying, and it was crackling the line. He said, "Oh, je call from the ambassadeur, ambassadeur, oui, de CBE." I said, "What CBE? What? It's a CBE." Let's get on to something important, you know, and we got on with the rest of the conversation. And I forgot about it until on New Year's Eve, was it? Or something like, whenever they announced it officially. I was in Miami and I got a call from the Press Association telling me I got the CBE. so that's how I heard about it.
Well, it's an honour you richly deserve because you've given so many people such happiness. But it's interesting, Claude, your husband, in a sense, was he responsible for you becoming such a big star in Europe, particularly in France?
Oh, absolutely, yes, yes. I went over to Paris for a one-night stand. No, a one-night...
We know what you mean. A concert.
Yeah, but in these days, you have to make that very clear.
Absolutely.
It was a showbiz one-night stand. You know what I mean, anyway. At the Olympia Theatre, which is a bit like the Palladium here.
Sure.
And I really didn't, I didn't want to go. I didn't speak French, and I'd been to France before, and I thought it was a sort of smelly place, you know what I mean. Anyway, I went reluctantly, and I sang rather badly, and the place went wild. So the next morning, I was in the office of the recording company, the boss's office, and he was trying to convince me that I should record in French. All I wanted to do was go home. And then the lights went off in his office, and there were no windows, and in came this person and stood on the desk and changed the light bulb, and the light went on, and it was...
It was Claude. The light really went up for you.
Yeah, it was Claude. And you know, to answer your question, yes, a few months later, I went to Paris, and we sort of had our little sort of fling, if you know what I mean, and 18 months later, we were married, and I went to France because I was in love with a Frenchman. It's
you literally fell in love with him as you changed the light bulb?
Pretty well, yes. I thought he was pretty dishy.
He is very dishy. We have a wedding picture of you both.
That's sweet.
But he really changed your life, because then you became this huge star in France, singing in French.
Yeah. Yeah, nobody could have been more surprised than myself, you know, because as I say, I couldn't speak a word of French when I first went there.
Was it your Englishness, do you think, that helped?
Yes, it was. Yes. In fact, I've got some records. I don't sit around listening to my own records, but I did listen to this one the other day out of curiosity. It's my very first record in French, and it really doesn't sound like French at all.
You know, do they find English women sexy there?
Not all English women.
No, no. I mean, I'm so used to people here thinking that the French accent is sexy, it never occurred to me that it would work the other way around.
I think they found it rather refreshing.
Yes.
And, of course, I was singing differently. I was singing in a more rhythmic kind of way. It was a different kind of music for them.
So you, as a result of this partnership, created all sorts of French records, but you also created some very nice children. And
yes,
we have
indeed.
Your daughter, Kate Wolf, here from Paris. Kate, how do you do? Thank you for coming. Now, all the time in your childhood, your mother must have been incredibly famous in Europe, in France, in Britain, in the United States. Were you aware how famous she was?
Oh, yes. I realized, actually, when I was very young, probably 3 or 4 years old. It's a funny story, actually. We were in Canada, in Montreal. She was doing a show. I was sitting in the audience watching. And at the end of the show, apparently, I rushed into the dressing room screaming, Mommy, Mommy, I just saw Mommy on stage. Suddenly I realized what I just said, how stupid, and I felt embarrassed. And that's probably the first time I realized.
Did she ever encourage you to go on stage? Did
no.
it ever occur to you? Why not, Petula?
Well, I didn't discourage any of them, but I'd been a child star myself, and I wanted them to have as normal a childhood as possible, but of course that's all relative. They didn't have a really normal childhood, but we tried to keep them out of the limelight as much as we could.
What do you do now, Kate?
I'm a painter.
So artistic, but just not music?
No, she's great. She does murals and trompe l'oeil. She's very talented. A whole lot of stuff I can't do.
And the other children, you have three?
Yes.
Are they scattered around the world?
Oh, yeah, very much so, yeah. Kate's a Parisian, out and out. She travels a lot,
yeah,
but she's really... She likes Paris best, I think. And Barra, the older daughter, she lives in Manhattan, in Greenwich Village. She's the one who just made me a grandma. 20 months ago.
Sebastian,
yeah.
Do you like being a grandma?
Oh, I love it. I love it, except that, it's a long way. I can't see him as often as I... Isn't he beautiful?
He is absolutely beautiful. But you kept these children away from publicity and from cameras and so on as much as you could.
Well, I mean, there was publicity, because there were always photographers around, but we didn't want them to go into the business. I mean, they were all three of them, because we have a son, too. All three of them were very, fortunate. They were physically very beautiful. And, of course, there were people always saying, can we have them in a movie? Can we have them in, photographs? And we kept them out as children. Now, what they do as adults is their business.
But you still must feel that you missed something that you didn't want them to miss.
Yeah. Yeah, but I didn't give them a normal child. I would have liked to have been one of those ladies who makes jams and, and the children come home and there's a marvellous meal waiting for them. And
Do we believe her?
No.
Not a word. Any other questions from the audience of this? Yes, sir.
Petula, when you were very young, your father was your manager.
Uh-huh.
The press stated that he was rather hard on you at the time. Is that all true?
No. Well, I had a pretty strict upbringing, but I think most people of my generation did, And we were also growing up during the war, and that was a very special time. It was a bit odd for all of us. But I have to say that discipline has really come in very handy to me.
You don't feel that he pushed you too hard?
I don't think so. I was a very happy little girl, and I adored my father.
But the two roles being combined in one person might have been difficult for you.
Eventually it was difficult because, I'd go home from work and I didn't know if I was talking to my manager or my father. And that's when things started to get a little difficult. I'm going to anticipate what you might say about Claude being my manager, my husband being my manager.
Is that difficult?
We were very much aware of the problem before we got married, and we talked about it a great deal before taking the plunge. And in fact, it's worked very well, very well.
Now, do you live separately? You live sort of separate lives, but still very close?
Yes.
How does that work?
I'm not quite sure. I don't know. I mean, you know, it's very difficult to talk about one's personal life in public because I'm sure we've all got stories we can tell about our personal lives, and it's difficult to explain them to other people. But it just seems to work. We're happy that way.
Sounds like a kind of partnership, doesn't it? Very good.
Yes, it is.
Yes, madam.
You had a hard-working childhood. Do you regret that?
Well, not really, no. It was my childhood, and I was living my experience, and it was fine. You know, I wasn't badly treated. I was hopeless in school anyway, so, you know, my work was getting me out of school. There were problems like, you know, I would be in school for a week, and then I'd be on a movie for 3 weeks, and I'd go back to school, and I had no idea what they were talking about, you know. And the other kids thought that was rather good because they were a bit jealous of me anyway, so they were getting their own back, you know. So she doesn't know anything about algebra. No.
How old were you when you first sang in public?
In public, I was about, I think I was about six.
Where were you?
It was in chapel in Wales. I suppose that's in public, yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
What language did you sing in?
I was singing in Welsh.
Do you still speak Welsh?
No, I don't. No, I feel very, very bad about that. I used to speak it fluently. Yeah.
We have a recording of you singing very young, in English.
Yes.
You must have been about 10 in the early 40s. About that is that it seems to be so natural.
Oh yeah, well it was and it is.
You weren't nervous, you just enjoyed singing, and from that very early age.
I wasn't nervous then. I was a very shy little girl, and singing helped me to get past my shyness, I think, and I loved the whole physical act of singing, and I still do.
You had some fantastic co-stars you worked with, for example Anthony Newley, who was a child star along with you, and Peter O'Toole, who starred with you in Goodbye, Mr. Chips, and Charles Chaplin, who wrote a song, and Fred Astaire, you danced with.
Yes.
Any of those your favourite?
Well, I had a big crush on Anthony Newley when I, you know, when we were both teenagers. We did quite a few movies together, and I had a real pash for him.
Reciprocated?
Not at all, no. And now it's kind of late.
The first man who kissed you on the screen, am I right, was Alec Guinness in The Card?
Yes.
They say it was his first screen kiss. Can you remember it as being a passionate moment?
It was... The earth did not move, I can tell you. Personally speaking, anyway. It was a very chaste little kiss. We had to do it several times, but it didn't get any better.
Did you get sexy parts, did you get, as you got older, or did they try and keep you very young?
I don't think I've ever had a sexy part, if you know what I mean. a sexy role.
Yes.
I've always been typecast, and people look on me as being very nice, you know, that nice lady. And I remember the girls saw me in Goodbye, Mr. Chips, my daughters, and they saw me in bed with Peter O'Toole. And I think it was Burra, the other daughter, leaned over to me and she said, "Mummy, you've still got your makeup on in bed."
That was the sin, was it?
That was the sin, yes.
Tony Hatch we have here, ladies and gentlemen, fantastic composer, a very, very now, you've written a lot of hits for Petula. What's her special quality as a singer?
Certainly the interpretation of the lyrics and her own special styling for the melody. I mean, there's no doubt about it that you can always tell that it's Petula Clark. And I've even heard her on records that I couldn't even remember making. And I've heard that sound and known it was her. It's very, very special, very distinctive.
So tell us about Downtown and how that got written.
Well, I first worked with Pet in the early 60s, and around about 1963 I was given the job of recording her on my own instead of just being the assistant on the recording sessions. And I wrote two or three songs for her, and we made a couple of records, and they weren't very, very successful. And I went off to New York to do some research, find some songs, and I got this idea for a song called Downtown. And I went off to see Pet in France, where she was living, and I was working with her there, rehearsing some songs to be recorded, but I never played this tune at all. I didn't think it was for her. I just didn't think she would like it. It wasn't even finished either. And she wasn't very happy with the songs that I was playing, and I could tell that, and we were running out of time. So she said, haven't you got anything else at all? Anything you've written or you've got an idea about? And so, well, out of desperation, really, I played her the melody of Downtown and just dropped the word in where it came. I didn't have any lyrics for it. And she said, that's the one I want to record. And if the lyrics live up to the tune, we could have a hit. Mm-hmm. So it was really her faith and her belief in it. And she saw well past what I could see in it right from the beginning.
When did you write the lyrics?
In the toilet, just before the recording session. Well, I had one verse.
I had one verse finished,
and the other one was finished really in the office about half an hour before the session.
Do you normally get your inspiration in the loo?
Many times, yes. There's always paper there, and as long as I've got a pen.
Yes.
I'd like to ask Petula. How did you make such a big leap from being a very charming little girl star to being a very sexy swinger in the 60s? I mean, how did you do it?
A sexy singer in the 60s? It's a difficult thing
to
say.
Not many people can say that.
Not a lot of people know that. I don't know. I didn't do anything, you know. I did a lot of growing up in France. You know, it just so happened. People have often thought that, you know, that I went to France to escape something, but I wouldn't have gone to France because I didn't know the language and I didn't especially like it at first. But it was a wonderful opportunity for me to grow up as a person and as an artist.
But wasn't it tricky? I mean, was adolescence tough for you?
Oh, yes, adolescence was tough, yeah. That wasn't good. That was really a difficult time. But I think it's a difficult time for most people. And for me, I was making all my mistakes in front of millions of people on television, you know.
Can you remember any particular moments that were tough?
I sang a song, because I adored Peggy Lee, and I still do. And I sang a song of hers called When the World Was Young, and there was a lyric, lying in the hay, games we used to play, where the willow hung, something like that. And of course, lying in the hay, games we used to play. You know, that was what? You know, our little pet singing these rude lyrics, you know. And I mean, we've got masses of mail coming in saying, this is disgraceful. And that's the kind of thing I was up against, you know.
So public was trying to keep you young and fresh and pure and the little girl they'd always loved. Yeah.
Yes, they were. And so it was stunting me. As an artist too, you know, I wanted to make a few mistakes, all right, make mistakes, but my own mistakes, as we all do. But I think by the time the 60s came round, you know, I was sort of a different person because I'd done a lot of growing up in France.
Well, we have some evidence, if people doubt it, because we have a clip from one of your shows recorded in the 60s. This one was in 1966. And one of the ladies responsible for showcasing you, sexy and glamorous, is Yvonne Littlewood. How many how many of Pet shows did you produce?
I don't know, over 40, one way and another. Because we first, it was very nostalgic just seeing that clip, because I haven't seen that since the show, and that was in the first series we ever did in 1966. We'd worked together on a few things before that. In fact, we first met in 1952 at Alexandra Palace, believe it or not. I wasn't producing then, but we met then. And we first started doing series in 66. And we've done a lot of other shows and been through a lot of times together since then.
Now, it's a well-known fact that all successful, glamorous women in show business really are quite difficult to work with. So you can be frank with us. Have you had tricky moments with Petula?
I've had tricky moments in shows, but never with Petula. She's always been great to work with, a real professional. And I can remember the first series I did with her, the realization of how she could use cameras. She had this marvelous communication, and for a director, it was a dream because I could take great big close-ups of her, and it was just superb. But we had moments that were not her fault, and I can think just after that series, we did a special at the Talk of the Town the following spring, which was her first all-woman show. It was for 45, 50 minutes. We were at the Talk of the Town, which was then a big cabaret room. It had a big stage show there all through the week, Mondays to Saturdays, and we used to hire it out on Sundays to do shows because we could get a big audience there. So we had this big audience, and because it was used as a stage show, it had a wonderful lift in it, which you could take down to the basement and then bring people or scenery up on it. So yours truly thought this was great. We'd use this to open the show. So it worked fine. We rehearsed it all day, and everything was right for the go at 8 o'clock. Cued the orchestra introduction, and then I said, cue the lift. Cue the lift. Cue the lift. And nothing happened. So after a pause, hold everything, stop recording. Well, we had to find the engineer for the room, because he knew the intricacies of this and how it worked. Petula was in the basement with one engineer who was down there looking after her sound. Nobody else could get there because you had to go down on the lift to get down there.
You were stuck.
And she was stuck. And she was stuck there for 45 minutes. We couldn't even get her a cup of tea.
Nightmare at the best of times, yeah. But when you were expected on stage.
Yeah. And we eventually mended it. The audience were very patient.
And she was in a hell of a state and fuming.
No, really. She was wonderful because we cued the music again, cue the lift, and up it came to tumultuous applause, totally unscathed, unfazed by any of it. She stormed out into I Know a Place.
Which she certainly did by then.
And tore the place apart.
Yes.
Hello, Miss Clark.
Hello.
Nice seeing you. Is it true that you turned down the chance of doing a film with the great Presley?
Elvis Presley.
Yes,
is it true?
Yes, it is true.
Why did you do that?
I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I do apologize.
What made you do that?
Well, I didn't see myself, you know, on a beach blanket with Elvis Presley. I know that sounds silly, but I don't know. It just didn't seem to be the right thing. Or maybe it was Claude didn't see me on a beach blanket.
But you did make some smashing films, some great musicals. For example, Finian's Rainbow, and that gave you an opportunity, of course, to dance with Fred Astaire. Mm-hmm. Intimidating dancing with Fred Astaire?
Terrifying. No, wait a minute. It was, until I actually did it. I was scared before I did it. And I rehearsed for 2 weeks with a man called Hermes Pan, who was Fred Astaire's choreographer. In fact, he looked like Fred. And I rehearsed with him for a couple of weeks, and I thought, oh, this is okay. You know, I can do this. And then the day came when Fred Astaire walked through the door. No. And, of course, they put the music on, and he took me in his arms, and it was the easiest thing in the world. He was just lovely. And he was just as scared about singing with me. And, in fact, when we recorded our duet, which is part of that song, after the first take, he leapt in the air and said, I sang with her, you know. Isn't that weird?
So what is it like dancing with Fred?
It was the easiest thing in the world. It was easy, and that was part of his great gift, was that he could make his partner look so good, you know. I'm not a dancer, you know. Not that that is exactly a Ginger Rogers type.
It's pretty good, thing. Isn't it? It's pretty good. You have
fun
there.
It's cute. And he was such a lovely man, apart from everything else, you know.
You've done a lot of musical theatre. In fact, there is somebody here who has seen you in The Sound of Music. How often, Gloria?
264.
we've got the programme, yes. Haven't we? In fact, there's a picture here of Maria von Trapp. Did you ever actually meet her?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yes, I got to know her sort of fairly well, you know. She was a total eccentric. I mean, she was a little bit, you know. And she didn't mind saying so. She said to me, you know, Petula, you know, there's no way I was ever going to be a nun. That's an Austrian accent. she says, I was crazy. I was like a mountain goat, you know, in the mountains. She said, do you think you could play her barefoot?
So what are we going to do about Maria is true, then?
Absolutely, yes, yes. And she loved it. She loved our production. She thought it was the best. I don't know if she said that to everyone, but she did really genuinely seem to think that it was the closest to the way she was. She was a tomboy, and that's the way I played her.
Very different from the other great part that you played in the musical theatre, Norma Desmond, in Sunset Boulevard.
Yes, but in between time I did Blood Brothers, which I adored, but certainly Sunset Boulevard was a totally different cup of tea, yeah. Yeah,
a very difficult part, an unlovable woman in a sense, you know, you feel for her. What was it that you found connected you to this part?
Well, I didn't like her at all at first, and in fact I didn't want to do it, and Trevor Nunn gently nudged me into it. And at first the logistics of the show are so difficult. I mean, apart from the portrayal, you have to cope with the costumes and the staircases, not just the ones you see on stage, but the ones backstage, and the quick changes. And I have,
what is it about the costumes?
Well, they're very, very beautiful, ridiculously expensive. I think Norma's costumes alone cost £250,000 for her only her costumes. For the first few weeks, I didn't know what I was doing. I really was so terrified. And then I got to know Norma. And really, I can sincerely say that by the end of the run, when we finished, I missed everything about going to the theatre, of course, but the thing that I missed most was Norma.
You're touring the country at the moment, and you've also got an album, and you've called them both Where the Heart Is.
Yeah.
Now, according to the proverb, home is where the heart is.
Yes.
So, where is home?
I was hoping you weren't going to ask that. I don't know. I really don't know. I'm sort of homeless in a way, you know. I have, well, Kate knows, you know, we have places all over the place, you know. But one that I can actually call home, I don't know. And so I know this sounds rather corny, but there are times when I realize that I'm really only at home on stage because I know where I am on what I'm supposed to be doing. More or less.
We, I think, are going to create a little bit of musical history, a little bit of television history for all your fans, because you have sung with Tony Hatch, who composed many of your hits in private, is that right?
Well, sort of parties and things, you know.
But never on television?
No.
Until today?
Until today.
Tony's there, the piano's there. He's created a medley of some of your great hits. We'd love to hear them, would we not? Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time on television with Mr. Hatch at the piano, Miss Petula Clark.
Every day when the work is behind you and the shop and the store put the lock on the door, just get away where your worries won't find you. If you like, I'll tell you more. Don't let the day get the better of you. When the evening comes, there's so much to do. You better put on your best, wear a smile. Just come along with me a while, 'cause I tell you, I know a place where the music is fine and the lights are always low. I know a place where we can go. I've heard it all a million times before. Take off your coat, my love, and close the door. Don't sleep in the subway, darling. Don't stand in the pouring rain. Don't sleep in the subway, darling. The night is long. Forget your foolish pride. Nothing's wrong now. You're beside me again. You're the only one that I rely on. A shoulder there for me to cry on. The hours alone that I'm without you, all I ever do is think about you. No one else could be so understanding. Even though my love is so demanding, every time you look at me, then you'll know we'll both agree that no other love could be. I couldn't live without your love. Now I know you're really mine. I've got to have you all the time. But I'm so thankful for what I've got. Yeah. Yeah, Tony. When you're alone and life is making you lonely, you can always go, well, downtown. When you've got worries, all the noise and the hurry seems to help, I know. Downtown, just listen to the music of the traffic in the city. Linger on the sidewalk where the neon signs are pretty. How can you lose? The light's so much brighter there. You can't forget all your troubles.